Okay.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for taking time to join me in Flower Power in half an hour. I'm Louisa Rucker, and I thoroughly enjoy sharing things about flowers. We've done two sessions together. I hope you've had a chance to see some of the principles of flower arranging, and today I want to expand your horizons with this. With the flowers done at Cedarfield, one of the most popular arrangements that we put forth on a number of occasions is the garden. A garden is meant to mimic a really nice garden outside. It's seasonal, it has infinite possibilities. So I want to show you how this is constructed today and hope that you will take perhaps even smaller containers and do the same techniques. This is an arrangement that can be as long as you want, as big as you want, as tiny as you want, and uses whatever you've got on hand. This is a good arrangement to forage for. You'll see a lot of local greens in this arrangement, as well as some local flowers too. Now, what I've told you in the past about arranging is one of the key things, probably the most important, is a root ball. When you're putting things in an arrangement, you want there to be a definite center. It can be anywhere in your container or on your oasis, but you want it to be a root ball, just like everything grows from a ball. Trees, shrubs, flowers all generally have a central area we call the root ball. So, now here's the difference about the garden. It is episodic, so it's going to have a root ball over here, it's going to have one right here, and it's going to have another one. These are going to be three major ones, but wait, we're going to do a second root ball right here, and a second minor one right here, and then we'll fill in with other things. Now, even before we start, to remind myself that these are the centers of the action, what I do is I take some sheet moss. Now, this is just like the moss that grows in your yard or in somebody's yard, and it just covers this area. You can peel this off of the ground. You can dry it, you can dampen it. Every time you dry it, it just takes a siesta, and then it comes back to life when you want to use it again, if you spritz it well. And this I have been dampening overnight. I've got a bucket back here, and I'm pulling off pieces the size that I need. Now, I have put these areas of my arrangement as kind of in time out. I'm going to use these to allow my viewers to see what I want to emphasize. You know, when you start a garden and you start with little teeny things from Walmart, Lowe's, Strangers, wherever, you very carefully place them and everything looks orderly and so on. And then as time goes on, they all do what they're supposed to do. They grow. And if you're not really careful in a garden, it will simply take over and there'll be no features. It'll all just be kind of a jumble. We want to prevent that when we're doing a garden for the house or for a public place. We want people to see what we've done. So, now with this in mind, you know where the pauses are going to be, and eventually it will all come together. In the meantime, I'm using some turntables here because I'm working in reverse to you. I'm working from the back of the arrangement. And every now and then I'm going to have to check and see if this is working, so bear with me. So, for our first interest area, what we're going to do is take something very, very pretty and showy. I'm going to move this over a little bit so I can work on it. It sticks away. I'm going to start with the greens on this. Again, they're the bones of the arrangement. And I thought this would be right pretty. Let me see how tall we want. Let me see. Because tall will make a difference on this, and the height that I choose will kind of set the tone for this. So I'm going to start with this, and I'm going to start toward the back of this part of the arrangement to get this in. And I just want something really pretty right there. I'm going to go ahead and do the same thing on the other end so I can make sure they're going to have a framework that pretty well matches, just because it's going to be much more balanced. The thing that's so fun about a garden is it's your creation. You can do whatever you want to, and you can decide what kinds of flowers you want and what proportion. It doesn't matter if they don't grow together at the same time because it's your garden. You could go to the store and get something that was a different season and be perfectly all right in your garden because it's yours. So, we've got got some definition here. Let's see what we can do in the middle. Where's my middle bar? This is another kind of eucalyptus. I've got baby yuc right here. I've got Solomon's seal, which is my new best friend, right here. And this is willow yuc. It's a eucalyptus of a different style of leaf. If you notice, it's smaller leaf than this. It's less exuberant. It's much more lacy and dainty looking. And that makes it fun to use. So I'm going to put a little bit of this behind it just to give me some depth. Okay, right here I've got the framework of my arrangement. I've got three root balls right here. These are the major root balls. So let's see what we can do with that. Now, the one thing they tell you in doing a garden, I've been taught, is if you assign a flower a role of being tall in one place and having personality in one place, leave that flower in that character. Don't take these and make a little group of them right here if they've already been established as a tall flower in nature, because that will kind of mix up the eye and not make it as satisfactory. Now, my sunflowers are growing at a slightly different level, but they're all growing as sunflowers right here. And if you notice, I've turned the second one to the side. If these guys face you, they look like giant eyeballs. It's not as much fun to see. So, we are trying to have them look in other directions so they'll have a little more personality. And I'm going to use three. Generally, I have an extra just in case, but generally, you want to use a an uneven number. It's something about the eye is affected by that. Now, the next thing I've got to go in here to add more color is I've got some safflowers, and I think these are so much fun. They look like thistles. They also dry very well. So, if you're using them and want to have a dry arrangement, that's good. I'm going to put one in the back, because from the front, that gives depth to my arrangement. I'm going to add them in just some different places in here. And I'm going into the oasis about an inch, because that will give them plenty of water and stability, which are very helpful in an arrangement. And I'm going to scatter these in. I want them to be seen from various spots in here. And I want that color to come through, trusting that it will. Let's see, let's add maybe just a couple more in here. And I want to keep these in a kind of a root ball because I don't want this to get just all over the place and out of control. I think that's been something that's been fascinating to watch from the pandemic when we've had less air pollution and less varmints this year in the garden, and they have just done so well, and some of them have become just voluptuous, maybe more than we wanted them to. While I'm at it, I want to add something on the side over here to kind of fill out this first little area. These are fig tree leaves. I never would have thought of these, just didn't cross my horizon until a neighbor was having difficulty in their fig tree was growing too big, and they said, "You have any loppers?" And I said, "Yes," and he said, "May I borrow them?" I said, "No, I come with loppers. I really like to lop. I'll come over and take care of your fig tree." And I ended up with a big clump of fig tree and used them in an arrangement. Oh my goodness, it's up on the side of the prominent side of the veranda. And I found out these little guys are wonderful big guys. But I also found out that they are very, very tacky in terms of their sap. And I got home and I thought, super glue. Whew. Stuff was a mess. So on this side, let's see what we got. Oh, we got some really pretty. We've got some balloon flowers. These are digitalis is the other name. And they're in the nightshade family. They're also extraordinarily pretty and really fun to use. I love the fact they're part of a bell. They're called balloon flowers in some circles. But just so pretty. I love the color. I'm hoping this purple will pick up on your screen at home. It's a hard color sometimes to get purple to show well, but it's just worth trying anyway. Let's see, I'll put this guy back here again. When you turn things differently as they grow in nature, they seem to give you a loose and graceful feel, which is very, very nice. Just to go with this, add a little more lavender. we use fig leaves over there. I've got some perfectly beautiful ferns right here. Ferns are always among my favorite because of their gracefulness. And let's see if they can work their charm on this. These are particularly healthy and very dark green. They were growing somewhere locally the other day. It looked like they would like to come to the session, and so they were welcome to be with us today. Just a little bit of that, look at the softening this adds, but I'm not taking up this area. This is still pretty close here. Well, let's add something to our middle theater of interest. I have raised this as a houseplant for the last year or plus, and I've had it outside on summer vacation, and it has been so, so happy. So I thought maybe it would like to come share with you today. Such a pretty plant, and they do last, I think they last well in a cut arrangement. We'll find out for sure today and just see. And with that, my plant was only so generous, and it only had two blossoms right now, but I found some nice allium. This looks like a snowball, and gives us the same colors in here. So we'll add a little bit of that to our white session right here. Okay, we have these lovely peace lily leaves, so those go in too. So you can see that they're kind of three interest areas here. But now we have these to fill in more and add more to our garden. I suspect it's hard to imagine where this is going, but we'll see. Oh, that's looking good. Oops, wait a minute. Somebody's, well, actually, through this way. It looks like he's out of place. We'll help him. Okay, let's see. I think I'd like to add some hot orange, or not orange, I'm sorry, hot pink right here, just to give something a little more life down here. These guys, and I'm going to make this in a slightly lower spot in our garden because I think it'll be prettier if they're up and down and give you reason to watch. That's pretty. The hardest thing in working on this garden has been to not overpick, not overplan, not try to fill this thing up, because again, it would look like many a garden that had just had too many pretty things growing in it, and I just don't. Really do want it to be a little bit less cluttered and prettier. But let's see how to do that. Well, we've got, we're going to put these together, but I think I can go over a little bit this way, even when I'm getting ready to put them together. And if I need to sort anything, I'll do that. So we've got lots of hot pink, and we've got a couple little pink ones here. And these are just the zinnias from down in the Parkland Garden. Spent some time weeding and realized these were running amok. And if they were running amok, I thought they could run into our garden. Very happy to see them today. We're going to change color on the other end. And let's see what that's going to do. I've got more of the orange in here. And I've got some hotter color here. Oh, that's a little tall for this. Again, I've assigned zinnias a role in this garden. About where they should be. So I'm going to keep them about the same height on here so they show up as being related plants. Actually, this is our purple and pink and our yellow, kind of reddish and orange coming this way. So it'd be fun to plant a garden that did that. Of course, the birds will take care of sorting that out a little bit if they have a chance. And it's so interesting to see how you plan your garden and then how it comes out in doing. Okay. So, now this guy's looking a little grim right here. Let's see if we can help him. Let's see what I've got over here, my bag of tricks. I'm sure I've got some good stuff. Okay, I've got some Pachysandra, which is a lovely, lovely green for him. Just a color and texture and presence to this. And this area in particular needs some of this right here because he has nothing at the moment. He's kind of naked. Add a little bit more. I also have some very pretty things that can go over here. These are coral bells right here. And you see them out in the front of the container gardens that Beth Burrell has planted. And they're so pretty. I'm going to have to adjust that a little bit when I turn this around so that it shows to its very best. But we'll kind of use it as a marker right now so that I can come the arrangement, but put them in water and just kind of put a few little posies with them, and have found that they last practically forever. It's been the nicest thing to have something that will keep on going like that. I'm kind of going over that edge, and I'm going to do something more edge in just a minute. I have some boxwood here, and that's always fun to use. You know, we had that big scare about boxwood Christmas before last, and there were just terrible tales of this fungus and problem that was going into boxwood. And I remember we could not bring outside boxwood here because, like COVID-19, they were afraid it was going to wipe out the entire population of boxwoods. And it looks like we missed it. I hope that's true. I've noticed that my boxwood that I was concerned about have come back beautifully. And that just makes me so pleased. Okay, let me see where we are right now. A couple little things in here will help at the moment. And then we'll get on to the next part of what we're doing with this garden. We kind of lay a foundation on one side, and then come back to it on the other side. Okay. Now see, I'm getting a little close here. I've got the bottom is empty, but I don't want the whole thing to be filled. I really want this garden to be a little tighter. So let's make a couple adjustments. Let's see about this guy. Looking preliminarily good. Okay, not much. Let me see. Okay, got something else. Aha! I do. Look at this. This is a tree hydrangea. And he's going to pick up our central theme of white in the center. Just a minor adjustment here. I think we can do this. Oh, do I like that? See what you think. What do you think? Going to work? And look what's growing out at the front entrance right now. A little bit of wheat or grass, whatever it is. And whatever it is, it's pretty. I'm hoping this shows up for you. It's very delicate. And it also, if you have a breeze, it's going to move in it, which is always a plus for me. I like to have things that have personality. So here's another one of these guys. So coming out the front. Okay, so he's set for the moment. Let's see about this one. This one's got a few more personality. And the one thing that's wonderful about working with moss, if you get to a point in an arrangement, you can simply add more moss if things aren't covered well enough. And that's been a real bailout a lot of times. I like having moss around for that reason. Okay. So, here's the next step. We're going to take these things off their turntables and put them together as they would be arranged. And they go much, much closer together, so I'm going to have to adjust again. And that guy is definitely too close together. We'll take it back over here. And I'll put these guys close like this. Let's see if they're still balanced on here. Okay, so our garden's coming together, and I see we've got a little pruning to do here. We've got a leaf that's way too far over. Our boxwood is encroaching here. We got a flower that's just trying to bloom over in somebody else's area. So, you see that even in a picturesque garden, you have to tame these guys, aim them in the right direction. Let's see about this one. I think we can take care of it. Now, here's the fun of the garden. The special fun of the garden. It's what you do from this point on. And what I'm going to do is start adding some things from the garden and from all the places I've collected stuff. And I'm going to turn this into a rock garden in here, quite specifically with some rocks. And this is the most fun part of working in the garden. Now, these have come from all of the places I have been collecting forever, trash container practically. But Dario's backyard and our neighbor, and it's been a really special piece of garden with that. So when you're doing this part, you keep an eye out for what's around. And I try to bring a rock back from wherever we travel. This is from Iceland, from the Black Sand Beach. And just a special one for me, when I loan my rocks out, and they do go visiting, it's with the understanding that they come back. Because a girl's rocks are really important, regardless of what kind of rock they are, if you're a rock enthusiast. So I've got some more of this, and I'm going to put it on the edge right here, so that if you were to walk around this, it would take your eye on down. And it's how much of this you use is governed by how much you have, how much time you have, and so on. But now let's do a little adjustment on here. We want these guys, again, to not be too tight. This is the one that wasn't doing well. Let's take it out of there. Let's see how we are. I'd say we're a little too tight right here. I'm sorry to put your back, my back to you, but it's hard to use it. Okay, so get that one over a little bit. Let's see, and again, this is something that you can just determine what you want to do when you're doing the garden. I think this leaf is overpowering here. So he's coming out. And just think about pruning your garden. That's exactly what you do with this little guy, too, to keep it from looking too overwhelmed. But let's see if we can add a couple of things that will give it a little more personality here, a little more distinction. And I'm thinking specifically about things that will come out of our garden and over. This is that little blue flower you see in the front containers by the entrance to Town Hall, to the town center. And they were lopping very nicely, and I thought they might enjoy lopping with us. Let's see if we can get them to do it. Just add just a touch of a different color in here. Now with moss, sometimes you have to take your finger in and make a hole in it, because the moss has been growing very tightly on the lawn. And if you don't want to go out and pick your own moss, if you go to A.C. Moore or Michaels, you can buy dried moss, it's called sheet moss, and it comes in a packet. And again, when I finish with my moss, I save it because I can re-dry it and use it again. And that's a nice little thing to do. Nice little thing to be able to recycle. Okay, we've got a little ivy, sneak it out of here. It's coming down there. Let's see what else we need. I think we need a little something on this side. You can't see that back yet. And I want to add another rock or two on here, just because they're fun. We'll take these places. So the garden is a design which you can use so many places. I've used this on a Thanksgiving table on both sides. This is so full. Let's see what else we can do. Move that guy over. I always talk about wanting the butterflies to be able to get through the arrangements, and sometimes when they get a little overgrown, that's harder. Let's take you out. And let's add a little bit more moss on the pattern. Oh, there it is. What I mentioned about being able to fill in a space, if you're looking at a garden that you put together and you have a little hole in it, there, you just add a little more moss to it. Now it's coming through nicely. That's not bad. Actually, this has turned out well in terms of problems with it. Let's see if there's anything else. I think maybe a leaf would be pretty right here. Now the ones you've seen here are probably the most interesting one. I've done one with a pool, a dish that became a reflective pool in it, and that was really fun. It had a little duck on it. But I did one time that had kind of a grotto effect here. It had stepping stone rocks, and you never know how these are going to turn out, because it kind of happened. And I was pouring water to refill it, and all of a sudden I realized I had a waterfall. One of the leaves had conducted the water, and for about 3 or 4 seconds, it was really pretty. It was a live action, but that doesn't work very well in places, so that's one and done. It was fun, though. Okay, let's get got to show a little better. Maybe another little lock will go in here somewhere. And another one right there. The other thing that's very interesting about this, if you don't want to use cut flowers like this, you can use potted plants. Three little pots of plants are fine in a line, a lot of moss on there, and then the rocks and things around the outside edge. Gave a luncheon for a friend one time, it was a birthday, so everyone there bought a potted plant. And we were able to put them in a garden, kind of a serpentine one, and add the extra things, and found that it was utterly delightful. And then at the end of the luncheon, we collected those from a basket in her home. And I think that was one of the most memorable ones. She ended up being able to keep them and enjoy them for quite a while, so that was really fun. I had so many things that I would love to have used in here, really pretty materials. This is a polka dot plant. It's a red and green spotted leaf, but there's not much room for it here unless I just stick it in the back so I know it's here and walk around the back side. And on this one, it works really, really well on a sideboard or dining room table, or something back to a wall is a good thing. And then you just have to do one side of it, the edges. If we are going to have it as a dinner centerpiece with a table with people on both sides, I would finish the back just like the front. And I would make sure there were no flowers facing this way to entertain the people on the back side. But that's it. What I'd like you to take away from this is these are episodic root balls in here. It's not one whole thing. It's breaking it up so you have different interest areas. The zinnias are playing the same role, so they're about the same height. These tall guys are different mixtures, but they're about the same height on the end and the middle. Could even be a little shorter, but it can carry its own right here. These are from all different seasons. Some of them are tropical plants. Some of them are in the garden. That's not a problem. Find what you like and just enjoy it. When I'm doing this, I try to cut the flowers at least 2 hours ahead of time and let them rest in water so they're really ready to come to the party. And then they're happy to play their roles. And there's one last thing in taking care of this I want you to know. When you've got a garden like this, you want to water it from the top, just like you would your garden at home. The tendency is to have a container and pour the water into the container in the bottom. And the flowers simply don't soak up that well. They would like to have their little holes that they've made filled up from the top. And I have my finger in the back of these arrangements so that I can see just how much water is going in. And I can make sure they have plenty, but it doesn't spoil the table. Oops, make one over on that one. The other thing is that these leaves are really good as acting as waterfalls. So those are things to think about. Well, this is Flower Power in the Garden today, and I thank you for taking the time. If you have any questions about it, you see me around, please ask. My joy is in seeing you decide, boy, I could do that. That doesn't look that hard at all. Most things are not. So enjoy your flowers. That's what I like to do. And again, thank you for attending today. Appreciate it.